This is 1986. The flicks, the fashions, the trends, the TV, the tunes. A totally awesome year that gave us these burning questions. Could Crocodile Dundee survive the Bronx?
He'd have got bitch smacked.
Was this the pinnacle of Corey Feldman's career?
What?
And was Hands Across America just one big germ factory?
Think of the amount of germs that were spread that day? This is why we have mad cow disease.
The answers to those questions, plus Goose.
That's me, honey.
Ducky and Teddy.
Come dream with me tonight.
Because you love the 80s. Because you've still got that killer Swatch watch. Admit it. This is 1986.
Bueller.
Ferris Bueller's Day Off changed my life.
Everybody wanted to be Ferris Bueller.
That's me.
I realized that I wasn't alone in never wanting to go to school.
You kidding me? Every kid wants to blow off school and go to a Cubs game.
The scene where he's up on stage in the middle of the parade and he's singing and everybody's going crazy and you're just like, man, that looks like fun. Everybody related to Matthew Broderick and wanted to be him because, you know, he got away with murder and he had a good time and he got the girl.
I was the only real, like, 17-year-old in that movie, the only real teenager.
Sloan Peterson, big crush on Sloan Peterson.
I can't really watch the movie. It's like having the most awkward year of your childhood played again and again and again and again.
I think I probably related more to Cameron, sort of the worry wart there.
Pardon my French, but Cameron is so tight that if you stuck a lump of coal up his ass, in 2 weeks you'd have a diamond.
Oh, Cameron? Great sidekick.
Especially when he's on the phone going, a family member dies, then you insult me. What the hell is the matter with you anyway?
It's hip to be square.
That's what I like in a movie. I like someone I can really relate to. Depressed, morose, pathetic, sad.
Okay, I'll go.
I didn't have the rich daddy with the fancy car to crash. No, I had the lesbian mother driving the Hyundai.
The central moral, the central focus of that whole movie is life moves pretty fast.
You don't stop and look around once in a while, you could miss it.
Totally.
Wheel.
Of.
Fortune.
It was not Wheel of Fortune, it was simply the wheel. 7:30, time for the wheel.
First of all, the show is Hangman.
Wheel of Fortune was an important SAT prep for me.
Pat Sajak is absolutely the glue.
You can tell that Pat Sajak kind of hates himself on Wheel of Fortune.
All right, we're back for... I'm wearing a microphone. I don't have to shout.
Sort of like, hey, welcome to Wheel of Fortune. I'm still doing this. Here I am.
Yeah.
It's me and our contestants. How you doing?
And I'm working on my first novel.
Yes, I am. Yeah.
You've got an interesting life in the military. I'm still doing this.
Come back and show us your Pulitzer when okay. You have it.
Vanna White. Man, was she hot.
She was just like a spirit of masturbatory fantasy for me at that time. I think some kind of a male ideal was tapped into where this woman never speaks and she's beautiful and she does what you tell her to do. And she can spell.
Who is Vanna White? Why is Vanna White?
The letter would light up and she would turn the letter and everyone's like, she is incredible.
Vanna made a career out of...
I mean, my 6-year-old could go turn the letter.
The worst part about Wheel of Fortune was yelling at the r**ds on there who couldn't figure it out.
I'd like to solve the puzzle.
All right, for all that money, what's this place?
Ooh, I messed up.
A slang term for sexual intercourse. Well, you get 3 letters. I'll take an F, a C, and a K.
Boom, boom, boom.
Do you want to buy a vowel? Not yet.
You took the money that you had won during the regular round, and then you went shopping.
Well, we're going to head into the den and let you spend your $900.
You'd have like $300 left, and all there'd be was the ceramic lobster.
Looking remarkably like a panda, this ceramic bear holds part of a bamboo tree for $129.
You'd be like, don't buy that. That's
plot of High Theater in Wheel of Fortune.
You got it!
Oh, my God!
A lot of human emotion in that game. And a lot of ceramic lobsters.
Bye-bye, everybody.
I love 86.
I did Hands Across America.
Did that May 25th, 1986. Hands Across America was this event that had a big build-up for months of, like, everyone was going to hold hands across America.
Hands Across America, to me, was a much clammier We Are the World.
We really did something that day. When we all joined hands, nobody will go hungry tonight.
I think it was for, like, hunger or peace or, no.
The Americans across our country will join hands in a single moment. In time, isn't that terrific?
Hands up, baby, hands up.
The cool thing was me, it was Diane Cannon was right next to me.
I was fortunate enough to be between Ally Sheedy and Crispin Glover. I'm a hand sweater, so I'm sure it wasn't very comfortable for Ally Sheedy and Crispin Glover.
I remember that there were a lot of celebrities involved in Hands Across America, and none of them were anywhere near me in the line. The person next to me smelled like cabbage.
I don't want to be touching people, I don't know. You think of the amount of germs that were spread that day? This is why we have mad cow disease.
We just would stand next to each other and, all right, three, two, and then we'd hold each other's hands. And I think all of us were thinking, how much longer until I can let go of this ass to hands?
I think we held hands for like, I don't know, like 10 minutes or something.
And let go. Everybody, and then we all let go. And then we all went off to brunch or whatever.
Wicked.
Hi, my name is Teddy Ruxpin.
Man, Teddy Ruxpin. That brings back some memories.
Teddy Ruxpin was a talking bear.
I think he went out on little adventures.
And you could get a book and get a cassette.
You could put tapes in his belly.
And he would read the book with you.
It's alive!
Its mouth actually moved, so it was even more disturbing.
I thought this was one of the most terrifying things ever put on a Toys R Us shelf.
Come dream with me tonight.
I think that whole concept is wonderful. Having a teddy bear tell a story.
That's sort of evil. I mean, that's not.
Why were we creating things like Teddy Ruxpin?
I had a theory that Teddy Ruxpin in the middle of the recording, had subliminal things in it. And Hansel went into the, you hate your parents. Tonight you will go in and kill them.
All it reminded me of is all those doll movies where the doll comes to life.
Is that the point where people stopped talking to children, so we had to create these hideous creatures to talk to our children?
It's just the biggest absentee parenting toy ever. Oh, I can't exactly have a robot watch the kid, but this is close enough.
Someday, just might come true.
Oh, I think it's, oh, please take this away from me. I don't like that at all.
I love 86.
Coming up, humor and the homeless. A winning combination.
Did you hear the one about the blah, blah, blah? Please help.
Baby on board? How about idiot parent on board?
I was going to ram into you, but since you've apparently got a baby on board, I'll try to hold back.
And ever notice Alf's nose looks like a certain other body part?
It's like ribbed for your pleasure.
Next on I Love 1986. But first, the makeout songs of 86.
Makeout songs of 86.
Ladies and gentlemen, I, Lionel Richie, give you the makeout songs of 1986.
Take My Breath Away.
Take My Breath Away by Berlin. Next Time I Fall in Love by Peter Cetera and Amy Grant.
Secret lovers, yeah. That's what we are. We
and Secret Lovers by Atlantic Star. The makeout songs of 1986. Do you feel the love? I sure hope you do.
Makeout songs of 86.
I'm Brett Michaels and I bring you the babes of 1986. Susanna Hoffs walks like an Egyptian babe. Kim Basinger, 9.5 weeks super babe. Stevie Nicks, Wicca Babe. Bette Midler, Down and Out in Beverly Hills Babe. And the Statue of Liberty, Fully Renovated Babe. And there you have it, the babes of 1986. I ought to know.
Babes of 86. I love the
80s. We have a visitor.
Alf? Yo, Alf was the winner. They need to bring that show back.
Yeah, I loved Alf.
Hey, Willie.
Hey, Willie.
I'm an alien from space who's landed here on Earth and trying to make the best of it.
This show about the puppet who's from another planet and he eats cats.
You are a bagel.
He ate cats. Alf ate cats.
Did he ever eat the cat?
Alf could never catch the cat because the series would be over.
How you doing, Lucky?
I still don't know how that show got big.
Because it's funny, man.
I liked the fact that there was a smart-ass puppet on television.
Hello, read my lips.
Rude puppets are always funny. You will never be able to escape the fact that a puppet going, "Shut up!" is gonna always be funny.
I'm lovable. I'm just a little high-strung.
Alf was like a furry E.T.
He was a blend of a dog and an anteater.
The nose was a little much. You know, it was like ribbed for your pleasure.
I think that's one of the most repugnant things I can imagine. I'll make love
to you. You know, back in the day, Alf was the man. Alf had it going on. All the babes. Get me Alf, man.
Though you're single, you're still looking.
Yep.
What's attractive to you?
One of Willard's toupees. Yes, it's true.
How did it last? How did that happen? And why is he trying to make a comeback?
Dial 1010-220.
I think it's ironic that the puppet from the show can get work, but the actors who are on it are having a hard time.
I loved Pretty in Pink. I loved Molly Ringwald.
Pretty in Pink, she's in the locker, and she's the nerd in school. Right?
I'm so humiliated.
See, but all of Molly's movies, they were all the same.
I can't believe you're actually saying this.
The standard plot is as follows. Molly Ringwald is upset about something, and then I come in and have sex with her.
Molly Ringwald coming from humble beginnings and not fitting in, and it was the story of the whole rich kid, poor kid, and the different groups.
I'm not really into all this shit, you know?
But they're attracted to each other and they want to be together, and everybody else makes it very difficult on them.
Molly Ringwald's best friend is played by John Cryer, and his name is Ducky.
Hi, Ducky. How are you?
We could all relate to Ducky, couldn't we?
You know, this is a really volcanic ensemble you're wearing. It's really marvelous.
My friends and I took all of our fashion cues from Ducky.
I'm off like a dirty shirt.
We thought we were punk rock, but in the 80s, nobody really knew quite what punk rock meant. So we sort of thought, well, Ducky's the closest thing, and it basically meant just sort of dressing.
I would have been annoyed if I had been Molly Ringwald, because the male lead had better outfits than she did. She got to wear pink, but he got the cool shoes and the whole thing.
It was Andrew McCarthy, my favorite.
Blaine.
Blaine? His name is Blaine? Oh, that's a major appliance. That's not a name.
And then James Spader.
You're a bitch.
Right. Who are you supposed to root for? The sort of good-looking preppy or the other good-looking preppy? I was rooting for Ducky. I was all about Ducky.
If I were Andy in the film, I would always pick Ducky over Blaine.
Papa, don't preach.
I thought Madonna was great.
I always have fondness for Detroit ladies. Still do.
Apparently the girl in the song has gotten pregnant.
She wanted to keep the baby.
Was that the basis of it?
Danny Aiello was her father. Who is not supposed to preach.
What if in the song she's talking about the fact that her dad gave her the kid? We never thought about that, did we? Oh, my God. That's horrible.
Papa Don't Preach, I think, was a really good attempt at really kind of trying to tell a different story.
It was about time, I think, that unwed teenage mothers had an anthem, and it was great of Madonna to write it. Papa, don't preach, stop loving me, Daddy.
Swatch!
I still collect them.
I had a blue one. That's all I knew, you know.
I own two. I think I own the red one and the black one.
I had a swatch. I think it was red.
The one that I wore all the time was just a multitude of like every color you could think of.
I was using a sundial back then.
Swatch watches were so fun because they came in so many colors, which were cool because you could color coordinate with your outfit.
You had to have a Swatch watch for your outfit.
And it had the Swatch guard, which is so funny because why you needed a Swatch guard?
It's like insurance for your $30 watch, the Swatch guard.
These are Swiss timepieces, handcrafted from plastic.
Swatch!
It's a plastic watch, folks. I'm sorry to break it to you, but they cost a nickel to make.
The new one came out with a new visual every day, and it's just like a whole little art world of watches that everybody could afford.
And that was like the cool thing to do, was to wear as many swatches as you could.
You better swatch yourself.
Wicked.
86, the amazing Mets.
The amazing Mets.
Everybody in the city was obviously fanatical about the Mets at that time, and they were a very strong team and went on to win the World Series.
I think the secret to the Mets' 1986 victory is that they were smoking a lot more pot back then.
And then here come the Boston Red Sox, who have been cursed since they traded away Babe Ruth.
Calvin Schiraldi trying to finish off the Mets and the 1986 baseball season.
Famous thing about that was how the Red Sox had the plastic over the lockers to prevent the champagne from spraying into their belongings and finally removed the curse.
And the Mets are down to their last out.
I mean, the game was over. I mean, our heads were hanging.
And then, my God, that final inning of Game 6.
Base hit. Little roller up along first, behind the bag!
Man, the ball went through Bill Buckner's legs at first base.
It was like this organic euphoria that came through. It was like every feeling of victory I'd ever experienced in my life all, like, came through my DNA in this moment.
Yeah, or Bill Buckner.
I felt terrible for him.
This past winter, they've shown it a lot on television, and I've seen it probably 30 or 40 times. It still looks the same.
Met so many Red Sox fans who, like, you can't even say Bill Buckner without them having conniption fits.
Then that becomes like the defining moment for that guy, and that's terrible.
A lot of people think that the ball rolling through Buckner's legs ended the World Series, but there was a Game 7 for the Red Sox to blow.
Got him!
There was so much noise in New York City, and people just went crazy.
And everybody had their windows open, and you could hear the city collectively cheering.
I mean, it was just the greatest moment in sports. Maybe the greatest moment of my life.
I love Hunks of 86.
Hi, I'm Tracy Elizabeth Lords, and I bring you the Hunks of 1986. Tom Cruise, feeling the need for speed, Hunks. Walter Payton, the Bears Hunk. Paul Hogan, Aussie Bushman comes to New York, hilarity ensues, Hunk. Keith Hernandez, amazing Met hunk. And Howard the Duck, overhyped hunk. There they are, the men of 1986. 100% USDA prime hunk.
Hunks of 86.
The Huxtables. We welcomed them into our homes, the original must-see TV kings.
Every black show from then on opened their show by dancing.
That's how black folks communicate. You know, if they ain't moving, you know, they ain't making a point.
Because you've got to know that the kids have got to have them get in here in the kitchen.
The Cosby Show for me was just like the pinnacle family show.
I like the relationship, the marriage that they had. They're such great parents, but at the same time, it seemed like they're always doing it.
Bring your cold feet over here.
The Huxtables are getting laid and maybe gonna make another perfect kid.
Theo's one of the best characters ever in the history of television.
I even auditioned one time for Theo. I do look like a Cosby kid, don't I?
And I thought Lisa Bonet was fly.
Lisa Bonet was happening, man. Ass Lady Kravitz.
kind of hard to relate to the Cosby Show, considering one parent was a doctor and the other was a lawyer. That was like, that's a strange black family for me.
He's a doctor. She's a lawyer. They're never at work. She never had a case. She never had a client. We never saw her office. She's got to be the worst lawyer that ever existed.
The horrible legacy of the Cosby Show was the sweaters.
Yeah, it's Coogee sweaters, and I have some Coogee outfits trying to be like Mr. Cosby.
There comes a point where you have so much money that all you can do is spend it on horrible-looking sweaters that nobody else can afford.
I loved when they would sing on that show, sing or dance.
They did the Nighttime is the Right Time once.
I said, baby, 90, baby.
I loved the Cosby Show because it broke the glass on white America's perception of what blacks are all about.
I love 86.
Oh, the baby on board signs were great.
I would not get a baby on board sign. I felt everyone had a baby on board sign, and I began to say, so what?
Like all of us, the first time you saw the baby on board, have you seen the baby on board?
Yes, wasn't that the coolest? Oh, look, there's the baby on board sign.
There's a baby on board. Okay. Nice to know it. What does that mean?
What's the assumption here that if I don't have a baby on board, feel free to collide into the side of my vehicle?
I was going to ram into you, but since you've apparently got a baby on board, I'll try to hold back.
Like, all of a sudden we care that our children are safe?
It's interesting. If you study the statistics, there were no traffic accidents in 1986. God, we saved a lot of lives that year.
Yeah, you got a baby on board. Great. I got a 16-year-old who I have a fairly good chance of getting a from. Do I put a sign on the side of my van?
And then the joke ones started coming out, like alcoholic on board.
Jerk on board and bitch on board.
I was like, I don't want to know what you've got on board. Move over.
If I never see another baby on board sign, I will be so happy.
Totally.
Two beers, all right? One for me, one for me, mate.
Crocodile Dundee. Now that was an interesting mess.
Wrestling alligators became quite hip.
It's a fish out of water story, really.
Crocodile Dundee came from the outback, which was all kind of desert and aborigines, and suddenly he was thrown into New York City.
Yeah, New York must be the friendliest place on earth.
Crocodile Dundee was weird in that they presented Australia as like this land before time where a car... A car.
The big appeal that he had, so that sexy outdoorsman kind of guy. I remember my mom was like, oh, wow, Crocodile Dundee.
Could he have been a member of the Village People? Probably.
Relax, Mama. It's just a movie.
The scene I remember most from Crocodile Dundee is the Bowie knife scene.
That's not a knife. That's a knife.
Damn if I didn't go out and get a Bowie knife and start carrying it around.
I grew up in the Bronx. Crocodile Dundee would have got his ass whooped coming to the Bronx. He'd have got bitch smacked.
The other good part of that movie was the alligator biting scene.
Could have been the birth of the thong right there.
She's in this, like, leotard with her butt showing.
Pretty hot for a teenager.
Paul Hogan got divorced and, married his co-star.
He married Linda Kozlowski.
She was all of a sudden, you know, the babe of the moment.
I love you!
Crocodile Dundee was like Paul Hogan's American dream. I mean, when you can make a movie that Americans, you know, go crazy for and find a wife in the process.
I just died in your arms tonight.
I love 86.
1986, there were all these celebrity weddings, like Tommy Lee and Heather Locklear.
There's one rule of rock and roll, it's you have to marry an actor model.
Nice day for a white wedding.
Dear Diary, today my life is complete. Heather finally found a man.
Start again.
It seemed so wrong that it had to be right.
Heather seemed like a little bit of a goody two-shoes. And then she hooks up with Mr. Anaconda in his pants.
Knowing what we know now about Tommy Lee, I think their wedding night was probably, you know, memorable.
Do they have a videotape of that?
I think when Schwarzenegger married Maria Shriver, it was all about his position in the United States.
I might have got you.
there was no longer Democrats and Republicans, because you cannot be a Kennedy and marry a guy who represents everything that Arnold Schwarzenegger does.
If she was getting good loving from a Republican, you stick with it.
That didn't work out, did it? Oh, it did.
Kennedys don't really have that much money on their own. They sometimes have to marry up a little bit. So she probably knew he had a lot of cash.
His muscles and her jaw, an unbeatable combination.
Tatum O'Neill, she did the Bad News Bears, and she was this tough chick.
McEnroe was an enfant terrible, which is Spanish for terrible guy.
Did it work out?
Oh.
You knew it wasn't going to last, but you knew it was going to be a good train wreck to watch.
I'll bet they had like these crazy dinner parties where they had insane fights. Or he would say something like, I wouldn't screw you if my life depended on it. And she'd say, oh, yeah, as if you could ever get it up.
Celebrity weddings make all of us feel better because we know that they will crash and burn and make us all feel a lot better about our own lives.
Whitney Houston broke on the scene in 1986, and she was like the biggest thing since sliced bread, and as boring sometimes.
She sings loudly sometimes, but it's on key.
I sang that at weddings. When I was a wedding singer.
You know, when you think about it, it's kind of perverse that loving yourself is the greatest love of all.
I remember, like, being outside, like, you know what I'm saying, with my boy, and I'd be all hard, you know what I'm saying? And then the minute I get in the house, I go in my room and be like, how would I know if you love me? You know what I'm saying? Like, yo, Whitney had those kind of influences on us men.
She just was the it, and she was gorgeous, and great body and beautiful face.
I remember that was the first one, you know, when she came out there just looking a piece of ass.
I've seen some of her old videos now with the hair.
She has like 8 weaves at one time.
Girl, cut the hair down a little bit. You know, it was just huge.
And she was funky and she was cool.
And it was like, hey, Whitney's cool, man. I like the way she dresses. You look back now, it's like, what was she wearing?
It was still kind of an 80s music where you can dance like this. And Whitney ain't got but so much rhythm, so it was easy to follow. Bouncing around, fluffy skirts, you know, yoo-hoos and yodels fall out of the bottom. You know, it was very kind of sweet. She was this sweet, wholesome, you know, little 17 model who had made herself a singing career. You know, she's a woman now. Mm-hmm. What's up, Bobby?
I love 86.
Coming up, tough talking Corey Feldman.
Is it me, or are you the world's biggest f***? I'm
in. Bootylicious Janet.
Oh, what's up, Janet?
And they called it comic relief, but there was no relief from Robin.
You know what it's like to be a man hung like a bear?
Robin Williams needs Ritalin, basically.
Next on I Love 1986. But first, this public service announcement.
We know people who never vote because they think it never counts.
Well, this year is different because we're doing something new.
I'm going to take a friend to vote, and together we know our votes will count.
Yeah, count a lot more.
Make this election different. This year, vote with a friend.
And make it count more.
Vote with a friend and make it count more.
86. Hello. Weird Al Yankovic here. Let's take a look at how the world has changed since 1986. Highest baseball salary. Then, Gary Carter, $2 million. Now, Alex Rodriguez, $22 million. David Lee Roth and Sammy Hagar. Then, Sammy replaced Dave. Now, Sammy and Dave have actually gone on tour together. And how about Ted Danson and Kelsey Grammer? Then, Ted was making $45,000 an episode on Cheers. Now, Kelsey's making $1.6 million a show on Frasier. Then again, Sam Malone got Diane and Rebecca while Frasier got Lilith. I think they're even.
Reagan, our president, 77 at the end of this next term, 77, and he has access to the button. You know, my grandfather's 77. We won't let him use the remote control for the TV set, okay?
Comic Relief is a charity for the homeless.
Did you hear the one about the blah, blah, blah? Please help.
Comic Relief was a fancier, funnier farm aid without the earth tones.
There's three comedians that said, you know, I'm tired of dealing with the homeless situation.
He's talking about the best in the business. Robin Williams, Whoopi Goldberg, Billy Crystal. This is the best.
I understand exactly what you're going
through. Oh, yeah, you know what it's like to be a man hung like a bear?
Whoopi does her impressions.
It's my pad. It's a split-level job.
Billy Crystal's the more, you know, he's more the straight guy.
I still rule. Mother.
Robin, of course, is definitely queer.
Robin Williams needs Ritalin, basically.
You ever been in an institution?
Yes, I went to the Institute of Fashion Technology.
Fashion Technology!
Wow! Comics showed up and they did about 5 minutes apiece.
I have a home, I feel guilty, let me say that right off the bat.
It was bizarre to have a very serious piece on the plight of the homeless in America and then segue right into Howie Mandel.
Comic relief was very, very disturbing.
A lot of poor people around, a fellow walks up to me and says, I haven't eaten in 2 days. I said, you should force yourself.
There's homeless out there. Let's laugh about it. You never saw homeless people at Comic Relief. They probably would have enjoyed the shelter.
There comes a time when you sure could use a laugh.
I applaud it. I'm all for helping people. And if you can laugh at them at the same time, great.
I love 86.
We need to go back because there is something that was missing around 85, 86. Janet Jackson hit and Control came out. That Joker was just wildfire.
And all of a sudden, Janet wasn't Michael's little sister anymore. You know, Janet Jackson was Janet Jackson.
First thing that she got control of was her booty. Because if you notice, when she came out, she was all bootylicious.
Bam! It was like... Oh, what's up, Janet? Those videos that she did, come on, man. What have you done for me lately?
Just the way she was moving around and dancing.
Doing her thing, you know, her little steps and the moves.
I'm like, oh, yeah, girl. Shoot. This is wild.
Hot. She's hot. Hot. Period. Janet Jackson, hot.
No, my first name ain't baby. It's Janet.
It's Jackson if you're nasty.
Nasty boys don't mean a thing.
Janet could basically tell you off in a song, you know, and check you, but it'd make you feel like you're talking to, like, the sweetest girl in the world.
Janet was like, like she really was putting her freak in. Remember back then? And she had the real black, real jet black curly hair, hair everywhere, and her booty was a little big right now.
She worked it. Every video, every song, and ain't looked back since.
Professor Principal, that's the only time in my life I wish I was a chair. She's like, I want to be that chair. I'll just be under you, Janet. Go.
I love 86.
You guys want to go see a dead body?
Stand By Me was one of my favorites. I love that movie.
I saw it like 5 or 6 times. I mean, I loved that movie.
It had to do with 4 friends heard a rumor that there was a dead body and that they were going to go check it out.
The kids have to work together, overcome their fears on this odyssey, and be in bed by 9 p.m.
Oh, great. Great story.
Lollipop, lollipop, oh, lollipop.
I like Corey Feldman's character. You know, he was the guy with the glasses.
Is it me, or are you the world's biggest f***?
Corey Feldman? Corey Feldman. Corey Haim?
Did you call me?
Corey Feldman.
Good movie, slightly handicapped by only having one Corey.
It's sad to think that Corey Feldman peaked when he was 12 years old.
What?
I knock.
And River Phoenix was just the best. He was so amazing.
Give me some skin.
But I thought, what a cool kid. A good actor.
River Phoenix blew me away. And I just knew this kid had it. Chris Chambers never misses, does he? Not even when the ladies leave the seat down.
And I remember Jerry O'Connell.
Oh, jeez, man, that's a goocher.
And he played kind of the chubby kid.
Was he the fat kid?
I don't like this. Sincerely.
And now, you know, he's a tall, good-looking guy in good shape.
Not that I was checking him out.
Oh, it's so funny, I forgot to laugh.
I remember when they went in the water and they came out with the leeches. And he had a leech stuck to his part down there.
Oh, the leeches.
And I think that used to bug me.
favorite scene in Stand By Me is at the end when Will Wheaton and River Phoenix say goodbye to each other, and he says,
"See ya. If I see you first."
I love that moment.
I think Stand By Me was definitely a coming-of-age movie.
They did grow, you know, they did change, but they were still little boys.
It was really a neat movie about bonding and friendship.
Little kids seeing a body, train comes, run away from the train, jump over the bridge. I mean, that's just good fun.
Yay!
One, two, three, four!
I thought the pairing with Run DMC and Aerosmith was brilliant.
Walked his way to grab to where it is today.
We're looking through these jammies, and we found this one called Walk This Way with the beat at the start. And Jay went, is that on the track?
Oh, I love that. I thought it was amazing. First time I heard it, I thought somebody was, like, doing it with a zipper on their coat. I didn't know what the hell it was.
And the riff is just monstrous.
And B started rhyming over it, and Jay kept going, is that?
I thought the video was great. They break the wall down, and here comes Steve Tyler, who's the man.
I swear to God, I thought the top of Steven Tyler's head was going to come off when he was singing.
The headbanger, with his mic stand appropriately, popped his head through and fired off the Walk This Way line.
Steven Tyler, like, crashing through a wall and stumbling and just looking like an old rock and roller, but we're back.
Run DMC kind of looking well-fed, let's just say, you know, and next to them just these rail thin, this grayed-out version of Aerosmith.
As shown by the advanced amount of pancake makeup Steven Tyler had on in that video, I mean, he looked like he was a corpse. I think that really relaunched Aerosmith's career.
On the stage, and they both have the Adidas with no laces on. Everybody in the world had to go get Adidas.
If you wore Adidas, everyone went, Run DMC. They put Adidas on the map as far as I'm concerned. But I always wondered, how do they keep on their feet?
That's kind of a B-boy secret. You just gotta slip them on and rock them right.
They were saying, look, we can do this together. It's just music.
It led the rock people to see what rap was about. It led the rap to see what rock was about. I thought it was pretty cool.
'86. Coming up, unlocking the mystery of the Iceman.
Why did he do that? Was that cool or something?
Your need for speed and shirtless volleyball is satisfied. Next on I Love 1986. But first, Mr. and Ms. 1986.
Hey, it's me, Andrew Dice Clay, with the moment you've all been waiting for. Time to name Mr. and Ms. 1986. I can't wait to do this. He was the young boxer that sounded like a chick. But God help you if you ever said that to him, eh? She was the young talk show host who just wouldn't shut her mouth. But she got such huge ratings, so she must have been doing something right? Mike Tyson and Oprah Winfrey, equal in popularity and occasionally weight. Mr. and Ms. 1986. I didn't write that. Will you give me that? I didn't do that.
Mr. and Ms. Born in 86.
I'm Soleil Moonfry. Here's a look at some of 1986's very special births. The Olsen Twins, the Goo Goo Dolls, Jolt Cola, the Pixies, and the Disposable Camera. There it is, the miracle of life, 80s style.
Born in 86.
I love the 80s.
The need for speed.
Top Gun. Loved it.
I love Top Gun.
It's where Tom Cruise definitely became a stud.
He was a wise-ass, smirking, good-looking guy.
What's your problem, Kazansky?
The plot of Top Gun is as follows. Tom Cruise flies an airplane around and then tries to have sex with that girl.
Loses his best friend, who's his co-pilot.
And of course, at the end of the movie, he gets the girl and wins the war.
I can totally relate to Top Gun, story of my life. Fighter pilots who, in their off time, grease themselves up to play volleyball.
Let's go! Okay, I guess!
That volleyball game is hot with a two T's.
With one of our lesser known lights of the 80s, Rick Rossovich, who flexes.
Cruz checked his watch because he has to leave. He flexed when he checked his watch. He was like,
want to know who the best is? That's him, Iceman.
As I recall that Val Kilmer character, what an ass, huh?
You need any help?
Favorite scene in Top Gun is the one where they're arguing in the showers.
You guys really are cowboys.
He goes, I don't like you.
You're everyone's problem.
Every time you get up in there, you're loose cannon, you're whatever.
You're unsafe. I don't like you because you're dangerous.
And he goes, that's right.
That's right. Nice, man. I am dangerous.
And Val Kilmer goes, that's just it. That was his whole response.
Why did he do that? Was that cool or something?
Ice was okay, but Goose is pretty funny.
No. There's two O's in Goose, boys.
Goose was the glue that held Top Gun together.
That's me, honey!
Plus, how many famous Gooses are there?
Kelly McGillis. She was hot.
Kelly McGillis, easy on the eyes. Yeah, I'd do her.
She looks like she could bench press you. You know what I mean? Kelly McGillis always looked like she would slam your head on the bar.
Hey, can I buy you a drink?
Sorry.
There was a shadowy tongue kiss that I remember as a kid. Gave me a tingle that I didn't really know what it was. And then I still don't. What was it?
Oh, God. I used to love that song so much. So much, in fact, that I think I heard it in a bar and just grabbed a guy and went home with him.
She's lost that loving feeling.
Well, and they sing and they do all this corny shit in bars.
You never close your eyes anymore when I kiss your lips.
You've lost that loving feeling.
Whoa. I can never remember the words because I'm always taking a flight into the danger zone.
It's a movie that I think hits all the right notes, and people just loved it.
It was just like a big splashy musical with airplanes.
I love 86.